Penguin Random House Audio presents Fire Cannot Kill a Dragon, Game of Thrones, and the Official Untold Story of an Epic Series by James Hibberd. Read for you by Fred Sanders. For my mom, who read the stories. Preface. Finding Westeros. Hundreds of men are screaming. The armored soldiers charge forward, howling with rage, their swords and shields clashing, their boots struggling for purchase in the thick mud. Slowly, agonizingly, some of the fighters are pushed back against a looming tower of corpses. The body pile is a mixture of slain men and horses, gorily intertwined like some gothic rendition of hell. In the distance, flayed men burn on crucifixes. "You are dying," yells an assistant director. "That's the main thing to remember. You are dying." It's October 2014. There are 600 crew members, 500 actors, and 70 horses in a Northern Ireland field to film The Battle of the Bastards. At the center of the mayhem is Kit Harington, who plays the reluctant hero, Jon Snow. He's been fighting Bolton soldiers for days, furiously swinging a hefty broadsword at one attacker after another. During one take, he performs a dozen intricately choreographed strikes that he has drilled perfectly into his muscle memory. Well, almost perfectly. Harrington suddenly gets knocked down into the field's boggy, mud-like soup. Weeks of battle filming have transformed the soil into a foul mix of dirt, horse manure, urine, fake snow, sweat, saliva, and bugs. The star gets wearily back onto his feet. "Become an actor," they said. Harrington groans. "Think of all the fame and glory," they said. Watching this battlefield spectacle from the sidelines, I marveled at the audacity of making Game of Thrones. My journey with the HBO drama series had begun years earlier, when I accepted a routine assignment. In George R.R. Martin's novels, the smallest decision in a character's life can have the greatest of consequences. But back on November 11, 2008, I had never heard of him. I was a senior writer working for The Hollywood Reporter when I interviewed a pair of first-time showrunners, David Benioff and Dan Weiss. HBO had just greenlit the duo's pilot based on Martin's books, and the show was an adult fantasy drama? What, you mean like Lord of the Rings? Not like Lord of the Rings, Benioff and Weiss explained. No wizards, no elves, no dwarfs. Well, maybe one dwarf. It's not a story with a million orcs charging across the plains, Weiss said, while Benioff added, high fantasy has never been done on TV before, and if anybody can do it, it's HBO. They've taken tired genres and reinvented them. Mobsters in The Sopranos, and westerns with Deadwood. My resulting story was utterly routine. The headline, HBO Conjuring Fantasy Series, didn't even include the title, Game of Thrones. The idea that TV's most prestigious Emmy-winning network would take a crazy gamble on an expensive fantasy show for grown-ups was considered the most newsworthy hook. And that should have been the end of my Thrones journey. But Benioff and Weiss's intriguing description of Martin's story stuck in my head. I bought a copy of the first A Song of Ice and Fire novel, A Game of Thrones. Like countless others, I fell headlong into Martin's daringly original world. Within a few weeks, I finished the third book in his saga, A Storm of Swords, which was the most exciting and horrifying stretch of page-turning twists and turns I had ever read. I began obsessively covering the progress of HBO's pilot. Colleagues would ask, "Why do you write so much about that one show?" I would reply, "Because if they can pull off adapting the books, and I don't think anybody can, it will change television." By the time the first season of Game of Thrones premiered in 2011, I had moved to Entertainment Weekly, where I embarked on a series of annual visits to the Thrones set. I was in the desert, when Daenerys stood outside the gates of Carth, bared witness to Sansa and Tyrion's awkward wedding, watched Joffrey suffer his well-deserved demise, was among the crowd for Cersei's walk of shame, trekked on a frozen lake during Jon Snow's quest beyond the wall, and paced Winterfell's ramparts during the climactic Long Night. Over the years, I grew to admire the cast and crew's dedication to making the best possible show, a commitment that often resulted in outright suffering. We're so accustomed to seeing life on movie and TV sets depicted as soft and easy, stars lounging between takes in posh RVs, directors riding around in golf carts on sunny studio back lots, a cast of heroes filming against a green screen backdrop for computer animators to later insert them into fabrications of harsh environments and deadly peril. The glamorous and comfortable vision of the entertainment world does exist if you're on a big budget production in Hollywood, filming on a major studio lot. That was never Thrones. The show was unlike any production, film, or television I have ever seen before or since. Working on Thrones was being wet and freezing for 11 hours, night after night, week after week, and learning to accept that sometimes you are going to be utterly miserable in order to get a shot just right. Thrones was being 6'6" Rory McCann, an actor made even bigger by his character's heavy costume and boots, whose only way to rest after shooting an exhausting action sequence was to curl up on the hard floor of a tiny utilitarian trailer, his face half covered in suffocating latex, a space heater making the drafty caravan either too hot or too cold. And while the production sometimes relied on green screen, more often, Thrones actors worked on wholly immersive sets that made you feel like you had literally been transported into another world. By the time the show concluded in 2019, I had written hundreds of stories covering the series. Yet there was much to the making of Game of Thrones that was left untold. What was Benioff and Weiss's first fateful meeting with Martin really like? What went down during the filming of the show's unaired original pilot? How did Thrones pull off its first major battle in season 2? What happened with the Dorne storyline? Why did the showrunners decide to end the series after 8 seasons? What were those grueling 55 consecutive nights filming The Long Night really like? And hey, why didn't Lady Stoneheart ever show up? My list of lingering questions, along with the desire to create a unified story from my decade of experience covering the show, is the reason for this book. Fire Cannot Kill a Dragon includes more than 50 exclusive new interviews with Game of Thrones producers, executives, cast, and crew that were conducted after the series finale. There are also many quotes that were previously published by EW, as well as occasional quotes that were reported in other outlets, which are attributed in the text along the way. Of course, no single book can capture the entirety of making a production as long-running and complex as Thrones, but it's my hope that listeners will find some fascinating behind-the-scenes stories here about the characters and moments they love the most. Thrones was also, it should be said, controversial, from literally its first episode to its last, and many of those topics are likewise addressed by the show's producers, directors, and cast. Surely not to the satisfaction of all, but you'll now learn why certain choices were made. Mainly, this book seeks to chronicle the colossal effort that went into making an extraordinary show. There is nothing more rare in pop culture than to build an alternate world so popular, sophisticated, and engrossing that it's globally embraced as a place almost as real as our own. J.R.R. Tolkien did it with The Lord of the Rings. So did George Lucas with Star Wars, J.K. Rowling with the Harry Potter series, and Marvel with its cinematic universe. Game of Thrones gave rise to a living, breathing world due to the passionate and tireless efforts of thousands of people. But it's worth remembering that it all started with one man. Chapter 1. A Dream of Dragons. Before the Starks and the Lannisters, the Dothraki and the Direwolves, Before the continent of Westeros had formed and the first dragon had been born, there was a boy whose imagination could not easily be contained. George Raymond Richard Martin grew up in a federal housing project in 1950s New Jersey. His father was a longshoreman, and his mother worked as a factory manager. He wasn't allowed to have dogs or cats, but was permitted to own tiny dime store turtles.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.